This symposium this evening is part of a series that we've been doing since 2011 related to the Fukushima and Tohoku disasters. We've probably done about a dozen events thus far. This in particular is focused more on crisis management and some of the lessons learned and discourses that have emerged in the last few years as people are trying to deal with the implications of the disasters and talk about reactor restarts. We have a very diverse and accomplished group of panelists here. We have with us Arnold, who is the executive director of the Ash Center for Democratic Governments at the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. He's here with David Giles and Hiromi Akiyama, both of whom are involved with ARN on an ongoing research project dealing with both China and also Japan in the crisis management of these disasters. In addition to ARN, David, and Hiromi, we have James Sims, who is currently just recently elected as the president of the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. James was a reporter for the Wall Street Journal and Dow Jones for a dozen years, and is a columnist dealing with energy policy today. And Scott Knowles, who is the director or the chair of the History Department at Drexel University. Scott is a disaster specialist expert, has a book by that title, Disaster Experts, and is doing work on various disaster scholars and institutes dealing with disaster response here. This entire group, along with myself and three interns that I'm dealing with, are all traveling up to Fukushima this coming week. We're going to spend about 4 days doing interviews in Fukushima City, Koriyama, Minamisoma, Namie, with government officials and crisis management people. So on the way to that, we've all collected here today to kind of compare notes and to work through our research. This is an unusual event because normally we do two-hour events, an hour and a half even, with one speaker. Here we have quite a number of people and an unusual start time. I suspect that ultimately by 9 p.m. when this concludes, we will have had something like two different events because we'll have people coming in afterwards, after their work. So because of the fact that we have three different presentations, and one of them, given by Arne, is on behalf of his research project, his team, we've decided that the best way to organize this would be to start with two presentations by James Sims and Scott Knowles. And then after that, we'll take a short break. And then we'll come back, and Arne will present on behalf of his group, and we'll discuss that. And we should have time for an extended Q&A at the end. So after the first two presentations, we will take a short break. So I will introduce each one of these presenters as they're coming up. And we're starting now with James Sims. James is, as I mentioned, had been a columnist for the Wall Street Journal and Dow Jones for about a dozen years. This last year, he was a Scripps Fellow at the University of Colorado at Boulder, doing research on seismology and particularly looking at the earthquake. James, as I mentioned, has also been elected as president of the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan that do a number of events, sometimes a couple of weeks it seems, related to Fukushima disasters. James will give an overview of the history of nuclear energy and policy in Japan. Thereafter, Scott will talk about how disaster specialists and other organizations have processed that information. So I'd like to welcome James Sims.
Thank you for the introduction. I'll start this up here. This was actually a trip I made up to Fukushima Daiichi last year, just myself and a cameraman. And we're actually going through the earthquake-proof sort of nerve center of the cleanup operation and efforts. And so we've got our
basically so we don't even guess what we can do in the future. There's really not much we can do about radiation. We just don't want to ingest particles. And so we had like a couple layers of socks and boots. And so as you can see, it's sort of a, I mean, this structure was actually completed just before the disaster. And a lot of people say that if this structure had not been built, that the disaster would have probably been even worse. And so as you can see, there's just, I mean, literally thousands of workers going in and out every day as part of the process. This is just sort of to give you an idea of, probably most people haven't seen sort of the inside of the center. Talk about Fukushima, and one of the things that struck me in terms of the history was I drove up there once, and then I took the train once, and the towns that you go through on the way to Fukushima, it's actually the road to Fukushima, literally and figuratively. And if you see, okay, so we're in Tokyo, and then Tokaimura. That's where Japan's first commercial reactor was. Tokaimura was also the site of one of the worst accidents before the Fukushima accident. And then Hitachi, the same name as the famous Hitachi group, which also makes nuclear reactors. And then you just go on up to Fukushima Daini and then Fukushima Daiichi. So I always thought that was just sort of a very strange sort of coincidence, and he had the road to Fukushima literally and figuratively. And so I'm going to basically go over a brief sort of history of atomic power in Japan. Actually, last year was some anniversaries of some very famous movies related to nuclear issues, and then also some of the regulatory history. So, I mean, as we know, the atomic bombings in 1945, one of the things that started Japan on the road to civilian nuclear power was the Adams for Peace speech by Eisenhower in 1953. 1954, Godzilla was released, U.S. first nuclear power, civilian nuclear power in 1955. And not long after that, the U.S. sponsors a civilian atomic power exhibit in Japan, and including of all places, Hiroshima, and sponsored by the major newspaper being the Yomiuri Shimbun. And then not long after that, Japan passes the first atomic energy based law. And one of the interesting things, I actually spent a couple days at the Eisenhower Library trying to look at the history of sort of U.S.-Japan nuclear cooperation. And there's actually a fair amount of material talking about the U.S. and Japan and how the U.S. was trying to get Japan to accept nuclear power, civilian nuclear power, I think partly to gain greater acceptance of atomic weapons as well. And this was one of the operations coordinating board, which actually was sort of the operations unit for the National Security Council during the Eisenhower administration. And so one of the interesting documents was, just in terms of the goals that the Eisenhower administration had set. And as you can see, seek to associate Japan and the U.S. in international planning for development of peaceful uses of nuclear energy. And that's basically from where Japan's sort of long road to Fukushima starts. Let's see. Okay, and then 1966, Tokaimura, the first Japanese power plant starts commercial operations. And then 5 years after that, the first reactor at Fukushima Daiichi starts commercial operations. And then we sort of get into the problems that the industry's had throughout the years. 1995, the Monju fast breeder reactor, they had a sodium coolant leak, and they actually covered up the accident by editing the video to make it look not so bad. And then 1999, there was an accident causing a criticality accident at the Shika nuclear reactor, and that was on the what you're probably familiar with, the International Nuclear and Radiological Event Scale Level 2. And then not too long after that was the Tokai Mura criticality accident, which left two dead, level four. Instead of doing the fuel production properly, they were using buckets and they caused a criticality accident, including what they call, I can't remember, that there's a Russian name for the blue flash of light. And so the people were, I think, hit, well, they're hit by, I'm just trying to remember the actual radiation type, but they died very, very horrible deaths. There's actually a very interesting documentary on that, which is actually kind of hard to watch. And so you had the history of the accidents, and then more recently, you had the Tokyo Electric Power falsifying safety records, including at the Daiichi Nuclear Power Plant, including on the cracked reactor shrouds, which is the covering on top of the reactor. And then again, 5 years later, TEPCO, a lot of other companies were found falsifying records again. And then we just have, you know, the continuing accidents. And then March, obviously 2011, you had the Daiichi accident. And the Daiichi accident was actually also very close to becoming a similar level of accident, partly through luck and skill, they were able to avoid an accident which would have ended up being probably a level seven as well. The regulatory history is very interesting because the Japan Atomic Energy Commission started in 1956. And the problem with the Japan Atomic Energy Commission was that both regulation and promotion of nuclear power were done under the same roof, so that creates a conflict of interest. The U.S., realizing that, split the Atomic Energy Commission into the NRC and what later becomes the Department of Energy, basically trying to get rid of that conflict of interest. I mean, there's still questions among critics in the U.S. whether it's really, really separate in terms of that conflict of interest issue. And then in Japan, I don't know if this followed because the U.S. had done something, but they set up a separate Nuclear Safety Commission, and also leaving the Japan Atomic Energy Commission. So we had maybe up to about four different agencies looking at it. In 1999, as I mentioned, the Tokai Mura criticality accident, there's sort of an aside on that. After the Fukushima accident, I called a friend of mine in government who had worked on nuclear issues, including nuclear weapons issues, and he had been in some talks with the Japanese government right after, or after Tokai Mura, and they were talking about what they should do with the regulatory system. The U.S. was saying, well, you should split oversight and promotion because you want to get rid of that conflict of interest. And the Japanese response was, well, thank you very much. You did that and after Three Mile Island, and you haven't built a nuclear plant in 30 years, so, you know, forget it. But what they did was they set up the Nuclear and Industrial Safety Agency, which was formed from parts of the Science and Technology Agency, which I think then was also part of the Education Ministry. Maybe it was separate. And the Agency for Natural Resources, which was under METI. But so basically everything was put under METI in terms of nuclear oversight for commercial reactors. I think some of the research was still left at the Ministry of Education. And let's see. So finally, I guess after the accident, the Nuclear Regulation Authority was established under the Environment Ministry with from NISA and the Nuclear Safety Commission. But there still is a Japan Atomic Energy Commission. So, I mean, they finally did what they should have done, you know, 10, 15, maybe even 20 years earlier. And, you know, I think there's some questions, especially like at that critical point, maybe after Tokai Mura, whether if they would have split oversight promotion, that things might have turned out a bit different. So this is the old regulatory structure, you know, what we call the nuclear village, or Makenshi no Kumura. And as you can see at the apex, and I don't know if many is the apex or maybe it's TEPCO, but you can see all the sort of back and forth, you know, including things like retirement jobs, and then the influence going back and forth. But obviously, you know, from METI to the plant makers, it's sort of back and forth. Utilities, obviously you have people retiring going to work at the utilities. Also from NISA, and then also for the Agency for Natural Resources. And I had also academics and media because I think they were actually complicit in what happened, because the academics would oftentimes just rubber stamp whatever the government wanted them to rubber stamp. And the media, you know, unfortunately, they kind of dropped the ball, you know, even though they did have reporters that were covering, you know, the trade ministry as well as the safety agency. And they didn't really, I think, dig deep enough in terms of, you know, issues like conflict of interest, safety issues, you know, what are the global standards, what lessons were learned from things like Chernobyl, as well as Three Mile Island. I'll just skip this. This is just a comparison of the two. And then one of the interesting things, and obviously this is probably the most famous report, I think, to come out of the accident. This was the Kurokawa report, which was done by the under the Diet. And obviously this is sort of the, I don't know what you would call it, maybe the money quote, regulation was entrusted to the same government bureaucracy responsible for its promotion. This led bureaucrats to put organizational interests ahead of their paramount duty to protect public safety. I mean, I think that sort of says it, everything. Now, in terms of the accident report, obviously, I think it was probably the most critical, and I think a lot of times their points are ignored because they're not very convenient for the government or the industry. And one of the issues that is sort of, I think, bothered me from the beginning is what impact the quake had on the plant. And as you can see here, they conclude that TEPCO was too quick to cite the tsunami as the cause, and that they believe that the quake damaged equipment necessarily for a safe shutdown. Now, there's been a lot of back and forth in TEPCO, and I think the NRA finally said that they couldn't find any conclusive evidence, but we really don't know because it's sort of a quote-unquote black box in terms of what happened inside. It's also, well, very inconvenient if it is found out that the quake caused some damage that prevented a safe shutdown. I mean, that would have a huge impact in terms of restarts here, as well as also, I think, in other countries that are currently operating plants that have a lot of quakes, and also in new construction in terms of adding to the cost. Just skip through that. This was a, they've already actually cleaned out this spent fuel pool. All the fuel has been removed. This was during the construction of the building to take the fuel out. I had just interspersed some photos that when I was up there. Let's see. Okay, I'm gonna go back. How am I doing on time? This was actually the spent fuel pool. We did a tour. They weren't actually doing any defueling. Or you can see those were the spent fuel rods that are in the pool. They were later removed and put into a common spent fuel pool. But the cameraman that went with me, he said, actually, you know, it's kind of pretty, that sort of green sort of glow is coming through the water. And I don't know if I could, I don't know if I would say that, but it's not as, I don't know. I mean, a lot of people think, oh, my Lord, you know, you're going to be a power plant that's had an accident. And there are actually some places that aren't so, there are places that are relatively safe. Obviously, there's still spots that are really, really hot and that you never want to go into. They were actually successfully able to take all the spent fuel out. This was actually probably the easiest operation in terms of cleanup. It's going to take decades in Fukushima. And this is actually another sort of interesting point, and it sort of ties into the issue of, which I'll get to later in terms of public trust in terms of the regulators as well as the operators of the plant. One of the issues that they had continued to have were the issues with the tanks. Now, obviously, these were built on the fly. They were bolted together to store the water that had been treated, and most of these, it was basically left with tritium, but they kept having problems with leaks. And, you know, I asked them, I was like, well, you know, couldn't you foresee some of these issues? And they're like, well, we're doing this, you know, on the fly, and it's very quick. But, for example, you see those, is there a pointer? Oh, there is. Is that, no, it's not a pointer.
can't see it.
Oh, right, okay. Yeah, right there. So these are about, I think, 30 centimeters a piece. So you would think, okay, storage tanks can leak. So, you know, in the U.S. or in Japan, oil tanks, they have like big earthen berms around them in case the tanks leak. But I think when they first built it, they didn't have anything. And so it's like, okay, well, there was a leak, so we'll build up one, we'll add one 30 centimeter sort of girder here to prevent, you know, stuff from overflowing. But then, oh, wait a minute, oh, we had an overflowing problem, so let's just add another 30 centimeters. But my question is, well, why didn't you just add something, you know, much higher to begin with? And I couldn't really get a good answer. And my guess is that, you know, they were overwhelmed, a combination of incompetence, as well as, you know, cost issues. I mean, I think that the water problems, for the most part, have been resolved. Sometimes when they have heavy rains, they do have some overflow issues. I'll just skip this. This is just me, I'm just sort of commenting on that very issue. So now to the reactor restarts. There are a lot of issues. After Fukushima, the evacuation zones were expanded. To 5 to 10 kilometers and upwards of 50. The one issue that's always come up is that only the immediate host communities and the prefecture have any sort of de facto veto power over the plants. And right now the public support, even almost, coming into 4 years later, the majority of the public basically is supporting an immediate or gradual phase out. And if you look at the opinion polls, the largest reason is safety. And as I've mentioned before, the issue of trust, often mentioned by the government and regulators, is also key. But as I'll get into a bit later, there is basically no trust in the regulator or the companies operating the plants. Anyway, this is just a graphic looking at the key zones for the disaster measures in case of a nuclear accident. And so depending on, you know, where your city is, there's a city like Maizuru in Kyoto, which is actually on the very edge, but they really have no say in terms of the operation of the plant. And so some of the issues when you're looking at the evacuation zones as well as the restarts is that the evacuation plans and the sheltering plans, that's not part of the vetting process for trying to restart the reactors. Also, and I will show you some pictures later, there are also a lot of questions in terms of how realistic the evacuation plans are, especially if you have like multiple disasters on top of each other, such as a tsunami, earthquake, and a nuclear disaster, you know, as we saw in Fukushima. And then some of the evacuation plans, they also talk about people going in sequence, but I think some people, they're not gonna wait, you know, and go in and wait their turn or use public transportation, and you're gonna end up with issues, you know, with like traffic jams. And then also the very serious questions of how to move people that are not able to move on their own, such as elderly, the sick. And there are just so many different issues, as well as who is going to accept the evacuees, especially if you have people that are sick or ill. How are you going to ensure that they're decontaminated, that they haven't been exposed to radiation? And so this comes to sort of the evacuation issue. This was in Takahama. And so Takahama, as you can see, the main road in Takahama, there's also a highway on the other, further back. But so if there's a tsunami, this road will probably be inundated because it's only 3 feet above sea level. So this is supposed to be one of the main evacuation routes. And the highway, if there's a big earthquake, it'll probably be shut down because I'll have to do an inspection to make sure that it's safe. And this is Takahama. Actually, the beach is actually pretty, very nice. on the other side of the mountains is the plan. And so this is one of the things that they've done because of the inability to evacuate people. They converted an old school into a shelter. And I think, well, I mean, it's sealed, and I don't know if they have like a positive air pressure to keep radioactive particles out. But one of the issues is that, for example, there's only fuel for like 3 days of electricity. So if you have to shelter longer, you're going to be kind of out of luck in terms of power. And this was the, I guess, the issue I brought up earlier about Maizuru. Let me see where Maizuru is. But this is Fukui, which they call the Genbatsu Ginza, or I don't know what it would be in English, Nuclear Rodeo Drive or Nuclear Fifth Avenue. So let me see, Maizuru, where is it? I'm trying to find it. So this is Takahama. Wait a minute, sorry. Okay, Takahama, and then let's see. I can't really see. Anyway, Maizuru is like on the edge, and some of it is actually within some of the evacuation zones. But I visited Maizuru, I think it was in January, and they still didn't have their full evacuation plans in place. And I'm not sure what's happened since then. But that's an issue of where cities are very close, but they're not really involved in the evacuation planning or have any say in terms of the operations of the plan. And this is just another opinion poll. This is looking at Sendai, which is going to probably be the first one to restart, I think, this summer. And as you can see, as you get closer to the plant, as you get closer to the plant, so the support goes up. But obviously, as you get further away, nationwide, it goes down. So this is basically asking whether you're for or against the restart of Sendai. So obviously, the economic impact is just actually very big, so you get a lot more support. Okay, so yeah, as you can see here, why do you support 43% because of the economic impact? And then even nationally, the question is, well, we support it because we want stable electricity supplies. But then when you start getting into the opposition, let's see, why are you opposed? 42% of the people that are opposed, they say because, well, I have concerns about safety. And obviously, maybe it's familiarity, but also, it's economic issues. The people in Satsuma Sendai City, it's much less, a bit less than the nationwide issue over safety. And this what I've been sort of coming to is, and this is a bit, I hate to say this in front of academics, but it's a bit academic, but it's actually very interesting because it sort of crystallized some of the issues that I've been looking at and hadn't really had a sort of a framework or way to explain. And this is a very interesting term which I learned last year, I think. It's called recreancy. And the failure of institutional actors to carry out their responsibilities with the degree of vigor necessary to merit the societal trust they enjoy. And if you look at that in terms of what happened in Fukushima and the history and the way the accident was handled, I think you can see why public opinion is overwhelmingly against the restarts. And in this case, this very famous sociologist, William Freudenberg, in this paper, he was looking at a proposed nuclear waste facility. And he said that recreancy was the largest determining factor whether people supported or opposed it. And that was higher than social demographic or ideological party affiliation variables. So basically, the people around that facility, they just didn't trust the operator or the regulator to do their job. And I think that's the case that we face in Japan. I have not been able to find any sort of similar studies in Japan, and if anybody knows of any, I would love to hear about it, because it really goes a long way to explaining the current situation that Japan is in. I mean, that said, I think despite the opposition that the restarts, well, they're going ahead, and as I said earlier, Satsuma will probably start this summer. And I say that, and I'm not pro or anti nuclear. I'm just trying to sort of understand why the opposition and why the opposition is there, and also the issues that are causing the opposition. And you know, if you look at some of the issues that I've gone through, you know, it's actually, it makes it very hard to really support you know, a full restart across Japan. Anyway, this is just another issue about risk. I'll just skip that. I don't know how I'm on time.
Yeah, we should probably.
Okay. So I mean, yeah, that's basically the conclusion. Is it's just a lack of trust. You know, going back to the not only the history but the handling of the accident, and that's definitely affecting you know, the public opinion going forward. Thank you.
Next up is Scott Knowles, who's the head of the history department at Drexel University, author of a book called Disaster Experts. He's right now working on a book, a project entitled The United States of Disaster. Scott is here for about 2 months on research project doing work on disaster experts. And I first knew Scott in 2012. He was one of the organizers of a special conference on the Fukushima disasters at University of California, Berkeley, a 3-day closed session with 30 scholars, and Scott was one of the organizers of that.
Broadcasting this globally, so we have to make sure that the atmospherics are just right. Okay, thank you, Kyle. Okay, wonderful. Thank you all for being here. Thanks to my colleagues for sharing their ideas at the workshop this evening. I'm really looking forward to learning from them as we go up to Fukushima City early next week. And I really want to acknowledge the leadership of Kyle Cleveland, who's a brilliant scholar in his own right, who's also provided really intense logistical support for me as I've prepared to spend the summer here in Japan working on a topic which I'm not going to talk about tonight because I don't know a lot about it yet, but I'm doing the research on disaster research centers in Japan, many of which have grown up immediately after 311. So in my talk this evening, I'd like to offer some perspectives from the history of disaster and science, technology, and society research, so-called STS research, on the role of disaster investigations, and particularly American investigations of the 311 compound disaster. So disasters bring the formlessness of risk calculations into shape in the faces of victims or the wreckage from an earthquake. Disasters also bring risks and their managers back into public view and under scrutiny, at least for a time after a disaster. The rapid and confusing flow of events in the midst of a disaster makes it difficult, it's a difficult space for the review of a particular risk and its history. Things are happening too quickly. As such, formal disaster investigations and reports have long stood as the venues through which chronology, causality, and blame are allocated after a disaster. Analytically, it makes sense to start by doing some lining up of interests, asking who wants the investigation and what do they want from it. An investigation may at one and the same time satisfy a professional organization, but not a regulatory agency, a legislature, but not an executive, one interested group of citizens, but not another. Learning from failure is central to the epistemologies of science and engineering, but the professional value of such learning goes well beyond design enhancement. The performance of what I call learning from disaster, which is a rhetoric we often hear from experts, is also a political act, placing technical experts in positions of power over the processes of sense-making and blame-laying. Now, writing in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, sociologist Stephen Hilgartner beautifully summarized the contributions of historical research to the analysis of disaster investigations. And he had three themes that he brings out, which I'll elaborate on just momentarily here. The first is that disasters, we shouldn't think of disasters as natural, and they're not aberrant. In industrialized societies, disasters are normal condition. We are living in disaster. The byproducts of the forces of modernization are disasters, particularly urbanization, industrialization, and the creation and maintenance of complex technological systems like a nuclear power plant complex. Secondly, political legitimacy in the modern state relies in no small part on the successful management of high-risk technological systems. After a disaster occurs, legitimacy relies on relieving victims, fostering recovery, and restoring public faith in the ability of government and industry to anticipate and prevent disaster occurrences. Thirdly, disaster investigations aspire to soothe public fears and restore faith in experts. This is a performance of a restoration of faith. Investigations may reveal negligence that open the door to sustained critiques of corporate, regulatory, or governmental leadership. And with so much on the line, disaster investigations may result in multiple parties trying to shift blame one to the other. And anyone who's followed the aftermath of 311 has watched this blame shifting taking place. There are associated efforts to limit the power of investigators, to thwart their work, and distort the evidence necessary to draw conclusions. I would submit to you that these three themes represent the foundation upon which any critical analysis of modern disaster investigations should be grounded. It's very common for technical experts to claim that a disaster opens the door to learning from mistakes. Again, the learning from disaster rhetoric. The assumption tucked into this thought is that disasters are productive of better technology and smarter risk-taking, making lemonade from the lemons. The disaster investigation is the laboratory and the courtroom of such deliberative acts. Investigation is, though, I would say, a normal outgrowth of the very scientific mode of thinking that brings these technological systems into place in the first place. But without an investigation, the system that fails cannot be redesigned and restarted. Okay, I'm going to shift over to some cases now and lose too many of you during the theoretical overview. That's good. The United States Nuclear Regulatory Commission and the Fukushima nuclear disaster. Within 2 weeks of the March 11 disasters, the U.S. nuclear community turned to the implications of Fukushima for American nuclear safety. The United States Nuclear Regulatory Commission put out statements early and frequently and created a task force that released a report in July of 2011, very quickly. In its report, the NRC lists 12 specific action items, the lessons learned from Fukushima, and the very first item listed speaks to the nature of the regulatory system itself in the United States, calling for what they said, what they called a logical, systematic, and coherent regulatory framework. The report goes on to explain the regulatory framework in place for nuclear safety in the United States. In brief, the framework consists of three parts. First, requirements for design-based events, controlled through specific regulations or the general design criteria. Secondly, we need requirements for some beyond design basis events, like blackouts and fire. So the design basis are the parameters within which a nuclear power plant is supposed to be able to operate. It's stress, but it shouldn't fail. Beyond the design basis is something that's beyond what the designers had put into place, but we hope that we could do retrofitting to make the plants able to survive something beyond the design basis. Thirdly, voluntary industry initiatives are called for, aimed at preventing severe accidents. And it's critical to take a moment to understand the terminology at play here and to see how the NRC describes its own history. I'm going to quote from the NRC here. Design basis events became a central element of the safety approach almost 50 years ago when the U.S. Atomic Energy Commission formulated the idea of requiring safety systems to address a prescribed set of anticipated operational occurrences. That approach and its related concepts of design basis events has been equated to adequate protection, and the concept of beyond design basis events has been equated to beyond adequate protection. The NRC continued to, so end of quote there, the NRC continued to use the design basis concept even after the Three Mile Island nuclear accident in 1979. Adding some new rules and orders as necessary to address new issues of concern. 120 new rules in total, some design basis in nature and some beyond design basis in nature. Fukushima presented new issues of concern to consider for the NRC. Of immediate concern were three major risks represented by the Daiichi plant's failures: station blackout, mitigation, design modifications to meet seismic and flooding risks, and emergency management preparations for cascading interconnected disasters. In each of these areas, the NRC set out to develop new standards of safety for American nuclear plants. and initiated studies and dialogue with industry as such. It's important to point out the fact that the NRC report, at least theoretically, had the opportunity through Fukushima to come to conclusions that would fundamentally alter the conceptual basis of nuclear safety in the United States. It did not. The conclusion of the NRC, quoted here, the conclusion of the report assesses regulatory practices in the United States. It's pretty clear. Although complex, they say, the current regulatory approach has served the Commission and the public well. And it allows the task force to conclude that a sequence of events like those occurring in the Fukushima accident is unlikely to occur in the United States. The American Society of Mechanical Engineers, the largest professional organization of mechanical engineers, one of the largest bodies and longest standing bodies of engineers in the United States, came to quite a similar conclusion in its June 2012 assessment of lessons learned, what they call lessons learned from Fukushima. The engineers accepted the NRC's core claim of the value of the design basis as a tried and true frame of reference for nuclear safety. Their report goes a step further, calling for a new nuclear safety construct. The new construct introduced two new concepts that went beyond the NRC's thinking, the all-risk approach and cliff-edge events. To quote the report, this new construct, as they saw it, would extend the design basis to consider all risks, sounds easy, right? And to include rare yet credible events, the new safety construct should be based on an all-risk approach, they argued, addressing a broad range of challenges to nuclear power plant safety, including internal and external hazards, like terrorism, during all modes of plant operation evaluated in a risk-informed manner. Cliff-edge events, so-called, those for which a small incremental increase in severity can yield a disproportionate increase in consequences, should be discovered and mitigation approaches implemented. The objective, according to the engineers, is to take reasonable and practical measures to deal with credible events, while realizing that the overall risk will never be zero. Echoing the perspective of the nuclear power industry as well as that of the NRC, the engineers argued that enhanced regulatory practice was not the best way to achieve the goals of this new safety construct. Rather, they called for accountability for the protection of people and property that must extend beyond regulatory environments to plant designers, manufacturers, owners, and operators. In other words, government shouldn't be doing the job. The private sector, the power operators, should be doing the job themselves, and that's the best way to achieve success to pull back from the cliff's edge, in their language. Ideally extending beyond the United States, they argued, and into the international nuclear community. As is clear from the above statement, concluding that nuclear power risk could never get down to zero is another way of saying that nuclear abolition, a goal seriously debated in Japan throughout 2011 and 12, was not in the cards for the United States. In sum, we see that from the perspectives of the U.S. science policy establishment, the military, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, the power industry, and the engineering community, Fukushima was a disaster from which much was to be learned. The key lessons, though, did not fundamentally alter the U.S. commitment to nuclear power or its support for Japanese use of nuclear power. Just a year after Fukushima, the United States Nuclear Regulatory Commission Chairman Gregory Yatsko began to push back against the notion that lessons learned from Fukushima were going to lead to safer nuclear power plants. So this is coming from within the NRC. He exposed dissent, his claims exposed dissent within the ranks not necessarily obvious from the 2011 task report. Yatsko had been appointed to the NRC in 2005, but from the beginning he was seen as an outsider to the established nuclear community. As a particle physicist, never having worked in the industry, Yatsko had more of a background in nuclear science policy. His aggressively reform-minded posture towards nuclear safety following Fukushima led to conflict with his colleagues at the agency and with industry leaders as well. In February of 2012, Yatsko was the lone dissenting vote on two new reactors to be built in Georgia in the United States, the first in 30 years in the U.S. He cited Fukushima as a reason for caution. He found himself, though, on the outside of the NRC and was berated, actually, before a House committee after his colleagues testified against him in his stance on safety. He cited long-standing safety concerns around fire, for example, and a practice that he pointed out of having workers walk around smelling for smoke as a safety protocol. Three new orders went into effect in March of 2012 requiring new safety equipment on all reactors in the U.S. and special instructions for Mark 1 and Mark 2 reactors allowing for water level monitoring inventing systems. These orders allowed nuclear producers until the end of 2016 to be in compliance. Such moves certainly grew from the lessons of Fukushima, and yet a review of NRC's actions by the Union of Concerned Scientists, so the third player now, raised troubling questions. The Union of Concerned Scientists is a 44-year-old organization in the U.S. of politically engaged and reform-minded scientists, often working on issues of environmental concern, frequently on nuclear safety issues. When the Union of Concerned Scientists found NRC's response to Fukushima commendable, it also appreciated the NRC 2011 report's emphasis on regulating beyond design basis events. Yet here's where their accolades ended. The union found that a year out from Fukushima, the NRC had, according to them, decided to put this first and most important recommendation at the bottom of its priority list. Their assessment goes on, quote here, that while the Nuclear Regulatory Commission has been deliberating on how to implement the task force recommendations, the nuclear power industry has jumped into the breach, proposing what it calls the diverse and flexible coping capability, or FLEX. And so the Union of Concerned Scientists took issue with the FLEX program, which allowed industry to basically undertake self-regulation. According to them, this approach appeals to the industry because it's cheaper than hardening existing equipment against natural disasters. As one industry executive commented, quote, it's cheaper to buy three pumps than one and a heck of a big building to put it in. Some nuclear plants have already begun implementing the FLEX strategy, which could make it difficult for the NRC to impose higher standards which FLEX equipment might fail to meet. The somewhat more activist environmental justice community in the United States, echoing international environmentalist perspectives on Fukushima, weighed in with a report in May of 2012. Greenpeace's lessons from Fukushima line up with the critical perspective of the Union of Concerned Scientists. From this perspective, after what we have seen in the failures in Fukushima, they argue, we can conclude that nuclear safety does not exist in reality. According to Greenpeace, the standard of self-regulation of the nuclear industry can be found in many places in the world. The Fukushima Daiichi disaster has demonstrated that the safety claims of the nuclear industry and its national as well as international regulators are false. Greenpeace then outlined a strategy for regulatory reform, including regulatory independence, public participation, and a rigorous review of the design basis against what would be considered modern standards and the new reality after the triple meltdown at Fukushima Daiichi. Given the risk involved, reactor safety reviews and life extensions should never be rubber stamp procedures, Greenpeace argued. Their report assesses Fukushima from a framework that works outward from core considerations of human rights and worker rights, and its lessons as to risk governance stand in stark contrast from those of the NRC and the American nuclear establishment. In the case of Yatsko, the Union of Concerned Scientists, and Greenpeace, we see a coherent critique of the lessons learned from Fukushima by the American nuclear establishment. These critics work from the premise that regulatory capture is the norm, and that the design basis paradigm is flawed inherently. A key point to stress here as well is the assertion that so-called outside expert groups are the ones most capable of arriving at independent and balanced assessments of nuclear risk. Certainly they would argue that. The Union of Concerned Scientists and Greenpeace reports draw their authority not only from technical sophistication, but more centrally from commitments to democratic practice in the governance of science and technology. By inserting the perspectives of environmental justice, human rights, and reform-minded regulatory practice, these critics provide a minority view, yet one that should be examined as we think more deeply about risk governance post-Fukushima. So, do lessons learned disaster investigations ever actually reveal problems that may call into serious question the safety of a technological system? It's imperative that we see lessons learned as part and parcel, I would argue, of larger political processes whereby risks are not assessed through some imagined neutral objective framework, but rather through the workings of politics, the gnashing and grinding of interests as they seek to expand or to curtail the use of a given system, like nuclear power. Now, I want to offer, as I'm moving towards the conclusion here, I want to offer two suggestions for this type of work going forward As we consider connecting the type of historically reflected analysis I'm doing here to concrete suggestions for risk governance, and of course with the caveat that it's always risky when a historian starts giving you policy advice, but here I go. First, I want to return to the NRC's notion of beyond design basis, so thinking the unthinkable in a sense, as a concept meaning basically to take extra precautions, to consider a worst case and work backwards into planning the design, construction, maintenance, and regulation of a nuclear power plant. Communications researcher William Kinsella's recent work is extraordinarily helpful as we think through the possibilities here. Kinsella notes what he calls the discursive boundary between the NRC's post-Fukushima design basis discussion and its beyond design basis discussion. By patiently documenting and then questioning that boundary between the design basis and beyond design basis, it's possible to develop some new paradigms of risk governance. Getting beyond the design basis takes us into a realm where boundaries between the technological and the natural and the political dissolve, where disasters reveal the deeper commitments within a society to policing the boundaries of safety and profit. It also has demonstrable technical implications, and costly ones at that, indicated by the evolution away from the limits of design basis thinking towards the all-risk idea suggested provocatively by the mechanical engineers. Secondly, lastly, another method to consider in this work has been outlined by Sheila Jasanoff through her concept of what she calls technologies of humility. Jasanoff would say that acknowledging the limits of prediction and control, technologies of humility confront head-on the normative implications of our lack of perfect foresight. And I won't read the rest of this to you. I'll give you a second to look at it. But the technology of humility is not just something that's built. A technology of humility can also be a regulatory framework. It could also be a new code of conduct or a new code of ethics for technical experts. Making Jasanoff's ideas more concrete, which is often necessary if we study Sheila Jasanoff, we can see her potentially productive strategy already demonstrated well by the Union of Concerned Scientists and Greenpeace. In the midst of post-disaster sense-making, it's imperative for reform-minded stakeholders to aggressively critique and then reconstruct the lessons learned paradigm that is so skillfully deployed by experts. Deploying the moral authority of victims, evacuees, and citizens more generally is central to the success of the technology of humility, if you go along this line. And that opens the way for very different kinds of disaster investigations and a very different method of disaster regulation and nuclear power regulation than what we have presently. Critics of the approach need only to return to the 1960s to find the banning of atmospheric nuclear testing to see but one example where strategic citizen engagement actually bent the seemingly unbendable trajectory of nuclear technocracy towards safety. And we can talk a little bit about that in the Q&A if you want to. In closing, reflecting on Fukushima in the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists in 2011, sociologist of risk Charles Perrow, we may know from his book Normal Accidents, brought the lessons learned debates down to a simple yet provocative question. It is important to ask, Perrow suggested, whether some industrial systems have such huge catastrophic potential that they should not be allowed to exist. How any disaster expert or expert institution answers this fundamental question gives us some predictive insight into the kinds of lessons that they will learn from Fukushima going forward. Thank you very much.
Everyone, as I mentioned at the beginning, because we have three presentations, we thought it would be a little taxing to have them all in sequence. So what we're going to do now is take any questions you may have related to these first two presentations, because they're kind of conceptually linked. And then we'll, after a few questions and discussion, we'll take a short break. We'll come back. Arne Howard and the Harvard team will give their presentation, and then we'll have yet another Q&A. So if you have questions now, if you could please come up to the microphone and state your questions concisely. And please make sure that your question ends with a question mark. The question's not stated. Okay, do we have any questions related to these two speakers?
We were very clear.
Maybe we'll have an opportunity later to discuss these as well. We are videotaping this, so if you come up to speak, you will be on the videotape.
I'm Tsunekawa, teaching at the National Graduate Institute for Policy Studies, a competitor to this university. I have one question to, the common question to the two speakers. The first speaker said very clearly that there is no 100% safety in anything. So people need to choose if they are ready, how much risk they are ready to take. So the people living near nuclear reactors, they tend to be more acceptable to the reactors due to mainly economic reasons. But the second speaker, I don't know what is your implication. Are you saying that if a huge risk exists, even if the probability is very, very low, that technology should be given up? I'm not very sure. But the reality in this world is that people, even if they are very fearful of this the possible effects of technological accident, still to live, they accept the risk. So I'm not very sure. The problem is there, but I'm not very sure what you want to say.
Thank you for that provocative question. What I'm doing in this work is actually documenting the perspectives of different experts who use the disaster investigations as a forum to have this very, to raise this very question, provocative question you've asked, which is the slide I ended with, which is, question is whether or not are there some technological systems that are inherently so risky that we cannot manage them effectively. And so what I tried to show were four different perspectives on that question. In other words, what were the lessons from Fukushima? And what I want to do primarily is get us beyond some thinking which the lessons learned rhetoric, I think, lends itself towards, that there are objective, neutral lessons that can be learned from these kinds of events. Because, in fact, the perspective of the people learning the lesson will have a very sharp effect on what kind of data they collect, what kind of framework they use to analyze it. So whereas the Nuclear Regulatory Commission or the American Society of Mechanical Engineers might look at Fukushima and say, there's some challenges here and some things to learn, the conclusion they ultimately came to was that there was nothing in it that was so technologically challenging that it couldn't be met by the methods of technical analysis and regulation that are already in place. What I was trying to do then is to bring in these other perspectives, which we may hear a little bit less, but are also very important. The Union of Concerned Scientists is no small organization, and Greenpeace has global reach. And here we have people who are also doing their own kinds of investigations, in many cases using the same, to a certain extent, same public documents that were made available by the Japanese government, but trying to shape that question in a different way, and to ask the Union of Concerned Scientists' primary question was, well, fine, we agree with you that you should be thinking beyond the design basis, but is that established, who establishes that standard? Is that established by industry? Or is that established by citizens who have to bear the risk, who live close to the plant? That's their question. And Greenpeace, as you might expect, is asking a much broader question about the overall safety of a power complex and the democracy of it in the first place. So, you know, the idea that we might come to a conclusion that, yeah, some technologies are inherently risky, all technologies, from an automobile to a hairdryer to a nuclear power plant, have some sort of risk. But I think the point of using these investigations as a historical tool is to show us that the way the investigations are framed will set a pathway to the kinds of conclusions that people will come to. I guess
Another way to say that is that probably the regulators and the engineers in the United States have come to their conclusion before they ask the question, because it's necessary for them to continue to manage these kinds of disasters. That's central to their professional claims. So I think if we take nothing more from this than that these investigations themselves are political, I think we've taken a pretty big step. It also challenges us, I think, to try to bring as many voices as we can into the discussion. Because if you're just listening to a government official, or if you're just listening to an engineer, and they say, yeah, it's safe, we studied it, it's safe. Well, that may work in some instances, but I think 311 has demonstrated, and as James pointed out, if the public doesn't buy that conclusion, then you've got a crisis. And how you manage that crisis of public opinion and trust is a big issue. So safety is not a one or a zero. It's not a yes or a no. It's a politically and socially and culturally constructed thing. And that's what I'd like to focus on here. James, are you going to...
Yeah,
have I given you enough time? Do you need me to keep talking? Or?
No, there's a slide that I didn't show, which it addresses a bit of this. I don't know how to...
You've got the parole piece. Would you like me to dim the lights?
Sure. Yeah, there was a slide that I didn't show, which is kind of interesting in terms of, I think, the biases that you have in the analysis. I blow this up. Kyle, how do I blow this up? Oh, okay, cool. I need to, I think, skip part of it. This is a paper, it's a professor that was actually at the University of Colorado. She put me on to a lot of really interesting papers, including the recreancy paper. But this is kind of interesting because, you know, in the risk analysis, and I think a lot of people, they sort of realize that there's probably some sort of bias, you know, depending on who's doing the risk analysis. And then I think the second quote, you know, the analysts with the highest degrees, highest levels of expertise and training, they work for the government or private industry. Thus, relatively easy for organizations to obtain the analysis they need, particularly with the budgets they have at their disposal and the controls they are able to exercise over those who do the actual work. Government and industry have, in effect, cornered the market on risk analysis. And I think that, you know, that happened definitely in Japan, but even to a more sort of perverse extent, where you had, you know, what I think the Kurokawa report called regulatory capture. So, I mean, just trying to get over this history, I think it's just going to be very difficult, even though, you know, the government is going to go ahead and, you know, move ahead with the restarts. But I think that issue of, you know, the biases in the risk assessments is sort of a key thing that, I don't think gets enough attention even here today. Because I think, you know, 4 years later, people just sort of, even though they're against it, there's really not as much interest in sort of following up, you know, in terms of issues like this.
I would just add one quick thing to that. I think that's also an index of understanding why there have been so many official investigators and official investigative reports. When experts in disaster are doing their work well, there's usually one investigation. And the public buys the findings of the investigation. Think of the Challenger investigation in the United States when the Challenger exploded, which was a very long, drawn-out affair. The public, I think, generally trusted the results of that investigation. I think I only talked about the American investigations, and I only talked about four. There's probably two dozen. And in Japan, there were three official ones, and then one extra non-official one that were done. And I think we sort of get this parade of investigators. That in part speaks to the lack of trust or authoritativeness of the findings of these investigators. So I think that's, I've never seen this many formal investigations done of one disaster before. Part of because of its complexity, but I think it's in part also because none of them have actually satisfied the public.
Collins has reminded me to come up with this question. How do you compare the 9/11 report, investigation report, which was published, versus those three official 3/11 reports?
Thank you for that question. And that's another section of this. This is an article that I pulled from, and I have another section on that. The September 11 investigation is also, there are multiple formal investigations. The 9/11 Commission report that you're discussing is mostly focused on terrorism and the lack of governmental capacity to effectively conduct counterterrorism in the 90s, and then the lack of government capacity to anticipate the event. It's a failure of initiative. There's only one chapter on emergency, maybe two chapters on emergency response. The collapse, and so I'll keep this short, but family groups, so groups of victims, family members, were unhappy with the failure to have a formal investigation of the collapse of the Twin Towers. And in fact, people who wanted to ask that question in fall of 2001, some of them were labeled unpatriotic, conspiracy theorists. Why would you ask? Why did these buildings fall down? Planes flew into them. Question closed. But the families didn't give up, and in fact, there were congressional hearings about the question of whether or not they should even investigate those collapses. And Congress decided that they should. It resulted in a multiple million dollars study being done at the National Institute of Standards and Technology, which was the most authoritative investigation of a building collapse ever done in the United States, and they came up with 30 points to try to instruct the construction and engineering industries on how to build safer high-rise buildings. Now, the coda to that story is that the World Trade Tower that's been rebuilt was started before those findings were ever published. So we sometimes run into this problem where the lessons learned cannot be fully absorbed because construction or reconstruction is moving faster. But I think it's an interesting case there where the political investigation and the technical investigation in that instance were separated. Thank you for that question.
Maybe time for two more questions, then we'll take a break.
Thank you. It's good to see someone from Drexel. I graduated from Drexel, so it's good to see someone representing Drexel overseas.
Are you employed?
Yeah. I changed areas, but I went from engineering to law. But any case, what was interesting was the issue of regulatory capture. It seems that a case in Japan where it's almost by design the atomic agency is captured by the regulatory because it was promoted. And in U.S., it's supposed to at least theoretically, supposed to be by design, to be separate. However, we see that even in the agency that's supposed to be just the regulatory agency, you still see strong regulatory capture. So I guess what it comes down to is how do you, or from your studies, how do you avoid regulatory capture? Because it seems that even in a situation where you design something that's supposed to not to do that, if you separate the functions, it happens again, and you try to introduce people to try to, I don't want to say clean it out, or at least try to, someone who's outside the agency coming in, they get extreme resistance. So it seems like most of these cases that all the disasters could have been solved. I know this is, looking back at the problem after it's been done, but technologically, a lot of these things could have been solved, and there was a whole bunch of things that the regulatory capture issue caused the certain risk analysis not to be done, or certain, basically my thought is that these companies are for-profit companies, and unless you have an agency regulating them, they're going to take profits over safety every time. And unless you have someone regulate them, they're not going to do that. But in every case, it becomes a regulatory capture issue. So again, come back to the regulatory capture. How do you see avoiding that? How do you see what recommendations have you seen from your studies that to avoid the regulatory capture issue?
I mean, that's a huge, huge issue that people have spent a lot of time looking at. I mean, one of the real challenges there, of course, is that, and the argument that's usually made whenever there's an attempt to reform the regulatory process is, well, it's the people in the industry who understand the technology the best. So they should be the ones regulating it. Why would you bring a historian or a sociologist or somebody else in who doesn't understand the technology? Now, I think that makes sense at a certain level, but you know, President Obama, when he was candidate, Obama actually pointed to the Regulatory Commission as the Nuclear Regulatory Commission as a prototype of a captured industry. So this is something that they've been struggling with. You get the case of somebody like Greg Yatsko, who doesn't come from industry but comes from science. I mean, I think that's one way you try to do that, is just to make sure that you have more expert voices in the room and around the table. I tend to think also I'm pretty actually swayed by the American Society of Mechanical Engineers idea that you should try to, insofar as possible, when you're building these protocols, you know, slow the process down, make sure that there are multiple steps of review and intervention. That wasn't in the paper that I gave, but that was another idea that they had. Greenpeace answer to this would be, we should have government regulators and the private sector, and never the twain shall meet. You can't walk from one side to the other. I'm not sure how realistic that is. You know, the other thing that you know, has been discussed, of course, is trying to create bodies within the process that are citizen groups. So they're not regulators and they're not scientists, but they're actually, it's sort of a democratic process. Again, that's going to slow things down. You're going to have non-experts in the room. But if the overall goal is to have a more sort of open, transparent process, then that may be the way to go. Part of the answer to this is part of the answer to the problem of democracy itself. My sense of democracy is that when it's functioning well, it's functioning noisily and slowly. So if you want things to fast track, or if you want a sort of perfect path, it may not be the most democratic path. I just close by saying that I think some idea that we could return to a magical technocratic past where there were good regulators, we're not going to find that. Because there's always, before the term regulatory capture existed, there were interested parties shaping public policy around risk. So I think it's always going to be an issue for me of slowing it down, getting more voices into the process. Thank you for that question.
So I think in the case of Japan, I mean, it wasn't just regulatory capture, it was, you know, government policy. At one point, I think by 2030, they wanted to get nuclear power up to 50% of the electricity generation. So it was, you know, national policy, and sort of national policy took precedence over just about everything else. And I'm not saying, you know, the national policy was necessarily bad or, you know, one way or the other, but obviously, you know, the way they set up the regulation, it could have been much better. Now, in terms of, I guess, you know, things that you can do, obviously, you know, I mentioned the media. The media in Japan was clearly complicit, partly because they got a lot of advertising revenue from companies like TEPCO. And so, you know, if anybody's followed the media here, and I hope there's nobody from the Japanese media here, but I think they're much more easily cowed, you know, by corporations and governments. And, you know, I deal with this all the time as, you know, in my role at CCJ. And I think, well, even in the U.S., though, you know, I always want to emphasize, because when I talk about Japan, you know, people, sometimes they say, well, you're just, you know, criticizing Japan. I mean, that's not the case. I mean, look at the United States. Now, the perfect example of regulatory capture is the nexus between Washington and Wall Street. I think, you know, I always bring that up as sort of the example to Japan's nuclear village. Clearly in the U.S., you know, the revolving door, it just sort of continues and continues. And, you know, the checks and balances that you would ordinarily have, I think, you know, with like Congress and the media, I don't think they're there. Oh, yeah, the checks and balances that you would have, you know, with like Congress and the media, they're not really there, I think, in the U.S. as much as they should be. As they weren't in Japan. You didn't have the government, you know, trying to, not the government, but the legislature the parliament, the Diet in Japan, actually, you know, making sure, you know, is the regulatory authority, are they doing their job? Are they taking into account all the risks? Or is it just, you know, pushing ahead with national policy? And then obviously the media issue. So, and there's a very good project which is actually at Harvard, Lawrence Lessig. He has, he said, I don't know if it's done, but it was on, his issue is structural corruption, basically to explain a lot of these issues. And structural corruption is not sort of the quid pro quo where, you know, people receive envelopes of cash, but it's this sort of, you know, regulatory capture and people thinking about their future positions once they retire from government, where are they going to go? You know, if you're thinking about where you're going to go, well, you're probably not going to want to upset your potential employers. So.
Can I add one more quick thing to that? I think it's also one more context that's important here to think about is that regulation, the term can mean different things too. To people hear different things in it. I think in nuclear power, commonly what regulation means is that as power companies have been privatized, right, then you need more regulation to make sure that they're providing a fair price to customers. So sometimes when people talk about regulation, they don't even mean the regulation of safety. So there's some slippage in the terminology there too. I think we sometimes have to be kind of careful to say, actually, we mean not just regulation of an industry as giving a customer a fair price without corruption, but also regulatory bodies who are focused on safety. So that's another wrinkle, and some have suggested that you actually need to really make sure you have separate entities within the bureaucracy, some that are focused more on the fiscal side and some that are just disinterested science wonks who are focused on public safety. But of course, that's going to mean more money, more bureaucrats. That's what they mean.
Go ahead. You have a question?
Yeah. I have a question to James.
Yes.
I'm from NHK,
Japan Broadcasting Corporation.
And I have over 30 years career as a news director. And how do you see out NHK's coverage about Fukushima?
I don't know, man. I've looked at a lot of the specials that have come after the Meltdown series, and I've bought actually a couple of the books, the big thick book on the Meltdown series. There's like 1, 2, 3, 4, I think already up to 5. That's actually been very critical, and I know there's actually been a fair amount of even pushback from the industry. I think, is there a lawsuit? They've taken it to some sort of quasi-private organization because they're saying that NHK, what they did and they broadcast was inaccurate, misleading. And the series is actually very interesting because they've actually raised a lot of questions that nobody else has raised in terms of what happened at Fukushima. And they've raised, I mean, really, really sort of wonky questions, you know, about like seals leaking and, you know, what happened in the exhaust stack. And it's just, I mean, that series has been very good. And I've heard from different people within NHK, you know, whether some of the later pieces maybe had been rushed and maybe so that's why it created some of the questions that have been raised by some of the, I guess, pro-nuclear people. Now, in terms of the coverage at the time of the accident, I know that there have been some people that were, I think, much more critical. They were, I think, pushed aside,
well,
right?
Maybe, but I think.
Critical or maybe much more concerned about what was happening at the plant, because I think the government, and obviously as the public broadcaster, you don't want to create, you know, a panic, right? So, but I've also later learned that populations usually don't panic, you know, like in the disaster movies where everybody's like rushing for the exits. But that's a very sort of, that's a very common, I think, misconception, you know, that the public is going to panic and they're going to be like, you know, crowding the streets and, you know, it's going to be like pillaging and looting.
It's simple.
Right, it's not that simple. But I'm just trying to remember back to the initial coverage. I mean, a lot of it, I think, was just fairly straightforward. But I know later, I know some people that I think that had quit because they wanted to, I guess, raise the questions, or they were much more concerned from the information that they were getting and what they were actually able to, I guess, broadcast. That I'm trying to think, there's one gentleman that who retired or quit, and now he's a freelance announcer. I can talk to you later. I can't remember his name right now. So, but I mean, the series that they've done, the Meltdown series, I think has been really good. And even if there are questions over some of the conclusions that the Meltdown series has raised, by the proponents of nuclear power, I think it's good just to get these questions out there. Because, you know, the government reports, all these reports, they didn't come up with these questions that NHK came up with. And I think, from what I understand, one of the Meltdown books is going to be translated into English. So that should be very interesting, just in terms of getting that out, and then also having people outside of Japan look at those questions and, you know, to find out whether those questions need to be raised with other plants, you know, around the world.
I'm interested in your...
It's not working.
So, I'm interested in your point of view as an NHK producer or reporter. What do you think about your own company's coverage? We are taping this, by the way.
I have to say that the rare chance for journalists to approach this kind of very difficult situation. And I have to say, I want to say that in Japan, that NHK has a kind of really higher position rather than other private TV companies to broadcast.
Status?
Status, I mean the trust, trustee?
From
yes,
the
yes. Especially for the disasters or the government situation or government comments, that we are kind of really at the middle position between audience and government. And we are stand aloof from the Kuroka Kiyoshi's report also, as you said. And we have so many stuff to get into the reality, to go into the Fukushima type atomic bomb. So many young producers, you know, work overnight for more than several weeks to find out what is happening there. And we're supported by the audience because they have to pay money for our broadcast. Unlike other TV companies in the world, it's a very, very rare position as a broadcast. But
I have a career as a news producer in more than 30 years in NHK, but I never feel any opposition parties to put into pressure. As you said, the government, or we are really independent, and our report is very independent. But as you mentioned, that this is a very difficult position as NHK, because people trust Japan Broadcasting Company very much. So as you mentioned, that it is very difficult situation. The people trust NHK, but sometimes we just in hesitate. What kind of degree we have to appear on in our program, the reality or what we saw in real. So we are always thinking about it. But I have to say that I want to say that it is a very unique character as a broadcaster in the world. So we are seeking our position in the 21st century. Because we have internet news, and I have conducted the international news section as a first trial of NHK. And the Pentagon sometimes called us in the midnight about Clinton's speech. Mm-hmm. Our translation is just a translation from Japanese script. Not we can write. The international section cannot write independently. We have to translate the Japanese script into English and just make it on air or make it on the internet news. So it's kind of very unrelevant character in the world. But I'm proud of our work.
Sorry. Thank you. I wanted to follow up on that. About 2 years ago, we organized an event here with Richard Lloyd Perry from the Times of London and Martin Fackler from the New York Times, who had a panel on media during national crisis, and they talked about their own media coverage. Martin Fackler wrote a book about the Japanese media coverage, and he was quite critical. Didn't exactly call it regulatory capture, but he said that they did not have a critical mentality. They were kind of accepting whatever they were told by the government. So you were saying, you know, with all due respect, you're saying that people trust NHK, and I think up until 2011, that was true. And what happened in the several weeks after that is that because NHK was so cautious about not being critical and going against what the government or TEPCO was saying, they maybe tried to adopt a neutral stance or just allow the government spokesman to speak without any critical scrutiny or contradiction to their claims, which was fine except when you had nuclear reactor buildings blowing up every other day for a week. And it became very clear that some of the rhetoric that they were saying was being contradicted by that reality. And I think the other aspect of this is that I have a family that are up in Fukushima, and for many elderly people, particularly in the more isolated rural parts of Japan, there's very little penetration of social media, you know, Facebook, Twitter, things like that. And so as a result, the only source of media they had was NHK. And, you know, from my vantage point, NHK looked like the British broadcasting system circa 1950. You know, very conservative and very institutional. So I think in relation to regulatory capture, the larger issue here is that Japanese society has not had a real strong civil society in which anti-nuclear, anti-authority, anti-government voices were given much coverage. But I think it is true that after several months after the fact, maybe 6 months after the fact, NHK did shift its focus, and as James has mentioned, it's now done some very interesting in-depth analyses that are quite critical. Now, when it really mattered, you know, they were kind of asleep at the wheel, but in retrospect, they have brought forth, I think, some very admirable coverage. So maybe the Japanese media has learned something from this experience. And maybe, particularly international reporters such as yourself, are much more sensitive to these issues than they were before.
Last question,
then we'll take a break. You want to respond to that?
Yeah, I'd like to respond to that. Not to defend NHK, not in any way, shape, or form. But I mean, you remember what it was like.
Yeah.
I mean, after the thing blew up, nobody knew what was going on.
The French did.
Yeah, but on the ground, nobody knew. I mean, there was no way to put any kind of quote-unquote accurate information up. At least they showed the thing blowing up on video. I mean, they could have censored that. But we didn't. I mean, I come from Ibaraki, and I do research on disaster community mental health. I just finished a Ph.D. on that. You have to admit that sometimes you don't know anything. And I think at that point, when the thing blew up, there was really new territory approaching us, and nobody could tell exactly what was going to happen.
They were not hiding anything.
They just didn't know. So we can criticize after the fact, but seriously, at the time, I'm not saying it's admirable, but nobody really knew.
Except the French.
I mean, I can address, I guess, a couple points. One, a lot of the reporters that were thrown into the coverage, including myself, you know, up until then, I was basically writing columns, but, you know, we knew it was a huge disaster, and you know, we immediately sent people up to Tohoku, not knowing, you know, that there was this other issue going on. And so I think that night I went to cover the Prime Minister's office and ended up at the Nuclear Industrial Safety Agency. And we were getting briefings, you know, from the bureaucrats, and they weren't really making it very easy to understand. But then again, most of us had never covered anything nuclear, and had no idea about, you know, sieverts or the different measures of radiations. And so we were really in the dark, and it took us a long time to sort of figure out what they were saying. But then I think, you know, within a couple of days, we sort of realized that we weren't getting sort of the full story from the regulators. And also the way they threw out terms, especially at the beginning, you know, things like metal down. And I actually remember talking to one of the bureaucrats, and I said, look, if you use the word meltdown, that means that the core is, it's gone. It's gone through the bottom of the, you know, the containment vessel. This is China syndrome. And I think he was later replaced because he probably said too much. So there was that issue, you know, the people that were thrown into it didn't really have the expertise when they were doing the coverage. Obviously, there are some people that were, you know, specifically covering science and technology issues at the, in the different media that had more expertise, but you know they should have been on top of this, you know, before.
But James, I think that's a really crucial point. That in the foreign media, they were consulting nuclear experts from the very beginning, and there was a divergence or disagreement maybe on the severity and the magnitude of the event, but they were consulting nuclear experts. In the case of the Japanese media, they were consulting politicians and nuclear industry officials, which had a very definite interest in kind of downplaying the nature of the disaster.
But I mean, as we know now,
I wanted to give you an opportunity to respond to that. And then we'll take a break.
First, I have to ask you that what kind of Japanese TV programs you can understand? The only English version or Japanese version?
I can understand
both.
We have so many kind of experts on, as you said, atomic bomb, or and we have a lot of connection with the Japanese professionals. So,
did you feel that the coverage was critical in the first 2 weeks of the disaster?
I cannot say critical or not critical, but we have to. We have to make it clear what is happening there, in the reality. First, our mission is that.
Just reporting.
Okay. Thank you. I think, in general, people did their best, and they were trying to tell the truth as they knew it. But obviously, we have different media cultures and different expectations on how the government's held accountable for their actions, and that was very clear in this disaster. It's an interesting issue. We've done an event on this. I particularly recommend Martin Fackler's book that's published in Japanese on this issue, where he talks about the media coverage. And Fackler and his team were nominated for the Pulitzer Prize for their coverage, mainly because they were offering some coverage that was not being put out there by the Japanese press. We have much more to go through here. We have a presentation by the Harvard team. If we could take about a 10-minute break, we'll come back, they'll present, and then we'll have time for further Q&A. Thank you very much for that interesting discussion. We'll be back in about 10 minutes. Harvard Kennedy School of Government. And they have a special project that's been going on for several years. Arn just got back from China, where they're also looking at disaster mitigation. And they will talk about crisis management and the Fukushima disasters. Arnold will talk first, and then in the Q&A, both David and Hiromi will respond to your questions.
Good evening, everybody. I'm very glad to be here and honored to be here to speak to this audience. A little bit daunted by following the excellent presentations of my colleagues, but I hope that our presentation will also lead to a spirited exchange of views. And I want to thank Kyle for inviting us and creating this venue for what I hope is a challenging evening for the audience as well as for the presenters. Our focus, and I want to acknowledge my colleagues, David Giles and Hiromi Akiyama, we've been working on a project here in Japan for several years. We lived here for 2 months in 2012, another 2 months in 2013, and now we're back for a little less than a month this year. The presentation tonight is largely the work that we did during the first year, which focused on the emergency response to the earthquake and tsunami, primarily, secondarily to the nuclear accident. And in the ensuing couple of years, we've been focusing on the process of recovery, now about to start its, basically in the early stages of its fifth year. And we've been trying to look in each of these things at the interaction between the different levels of government here in Japan, the national government, the prefectural governments, and local governments throughout this process. My focus is somewhat different than what Scott and James have been talking about. First of all, I think we're interested in a somewhat broader range of disasters, not necessarily, but certainly not excluding those that are primarily technological system failures, as the Fukushima accident was, but including also disasters that involve natural events like earthquakes, tsunamis, volcanic eruptions, typhoons, tornadoes, and the like. Disasters that may involve biological systems, particularly infectious disease, and finally, issues that involve terrorism. Of course, all of these things, whether resulting directly from human systems like the technologies that we've been talking about so far this evening, or even natural disasters like typhoons or tsunamis, interact with human systems. And so disasters are never completely natural disasters or completely biological ones. They are disasters in which there's an interaction between those kinds of events and the human systems. Our focus in this work has been to think about, first of all, to acknowledge a point that both James and Scott made, which is that inevitably there are going to be events of this sort, no matter how carefully we think through our technologies, no matter how carefully we design our systems, no matter how carefully we create venues in which there is popular input as well as technical and business input, disasters are going to happen. And our concern is how to organize society's capability of responding to those events, providing rescue to the people who need to be rescued, trying to restore basic services in society, and to initiate the early stages of recovery, which is what we'll be talking about tonight. Those phases that pretty much occur in the first days or weeks of a disaster. And we are particularly focused on what one might call landscape-scale disasters. As the name implies, these are events that occur over fairly large or often very large geographic areas, of which certainly the Great East Japan earthquake is an example. But it is by no means the only disaster of that type that has occurred even in recent years. And indeed, if we look at the 21st century, we can easily assemble a list of 10 or 12 events of that sort. Just in recent years, we've had, in fact, this year, we had the earthquake in Nepal. A year earlier, we had the terrible typhoon Haiyan that hit the Philippines. Pakistan and Thailand experienced devastating floods. in 2010. China experienced the Wenchuan earthquake in 2008. The list goes on, and so there are a lot of large-scale events. And our concern is how society can better organize itself to deal with those kinds of events. What I'd like to do tonight is to look, first of all, at some of the reforms, the Japanese system, as it existed both before 1995 and the Hanshin and Awaji earthquake that devastated Kobe and surrounding areas, the reforms that were instituted after that, and then ask the question of how well those things worked in the response to the earthquake, tsunami, and nuclear accident in 2011. My review of those events is going to be relatively brief, although we could talk about it at enormous length, because what I most like to do is make an argument that goes beyond the Japanese example and suggest that we need to think about organizing emergency response in different ways than we've typically done that. So more on that as we proceed. In 1995, the Japanese government was heavily criticized for the very slow response, particularly that the national government made to the earthquake that struck Kobe. And in the aftermath of that earthquake, there were a number of reforms that were instituted. The system before that relied extremely heavily on local government. The responsibility for disaster response was mainly there. Prefectural governments were supposed to aid them and push them a little bit, but they that was often honored in the breach. The national government was prepared in large events to intervene, but there were a number of features that of the law at that time which made that response slow and created disincentives for local government to ask for it. So for example, if the self-defense force was going to be deployed to help, local governments would have to foot the bill for self-defense force actions, which certainly was a disincentive for them to ask for that kind of help. The post-Kobe earthquake reforms had several features, and some of it was to strengthen the requirements for planning and preparedness by both local governments and prefectural governments. But the main thrust of those reforms really aimed at the national government, and particularly to create much stronger central authority and a greater central role so that the national government could take steps more quickly and more effectively in a way that would count, that essentially would counter some of the criticism that was leveled at it during the Kobe experience. And that included creating a position of Deputy Cabinet Secretary for Crisis Management, giving the Prime Minister greater authority, trying to create an organizational infrastructure in the national government that could take a larger role. So the general thrust of this was to centralize authority. The Great East Japan earthquake and the tsunami and nuclear accident that followed were in some ways the first big test of that post-Kobe framework. Of course, the tsunami followed the earthquake, devastated the Tohoku region along the Senriku coast and also in the Fukushima area. It led to the nuclear accident at Fukushima Daiichi and the very near miss nuclear accident at Fukushima Daini, just a few miles away. And the question that you might ask about centralized command of the emergency response to these enormous events is, what kinds of conditions would have to have prevailed for that kind of organization of emergency response to have worked effectively? And so what I'd like to do is state those kinds of conditions and then look at what actually happened in the example, the Great East Japan earthquake example, and then broaden that discussion out and ask whether this is typical of these kinds of events or not. So one kind of condition would be that in order to exercise central command, you'd need to have substantial knowledge about what was going on at the scene of the disaster, and also both for the responders who were at the scene and also in the central command post so that they could effectively give orders or make suggestions to the people in the field. Secondly, you would want to have effective communication flows so that people at the center would know what was going on at the periphery, and that those information flows would work both up from the periphery to the center, that instructions or requests for further information could flow down, and there also needed to would need to be horizontal communication so that people in one location, say on the coast, would be able to know roughly what was happening in other parts, and so that they could share resources if necessary and understand some of the tactics that were being used to deal with it. You'd also want to be able to have effective planning and decision making at the center during the disaster, not just before the disaster, that would guide the implementers in the field so that the central directions could be effectively acted upon. You'd want to have responsive implementers who would acknowledge the authority of the center and follow those technical objectives. And finally, as the response proceeded, you'd want to have timely feedback so that people could evaluate whether what they were doing was effective and make corrective actions as conditions changed or as they discovered that the things that they were doing were not in fact working. So to what extent did those conditions prevail in the aftermath of the Great East Japan earthquake? Well, in the immediate aftermath, right at the local level, in the many jurisdictions along the coast, particularly in Iwate and Miyagi and Fukushima, to some extent in Chiba, the affected communities were confused, they were disoriented, they were tremendously disrupted, they were cut off from communication, and that the governments of those communities, which were supposed to be taking the lead in responding to the emergency, were often either incapacitated by the death of key officials or their grief and loss and family members dying or property being lost, or the damage to their communities made it very difficult for them to know what was going on, even a kilometer or two away from where they were when the disaster happened. If we move from the local level to the prefectural headquarters in, say, in Morioka or in Sendai or in Fukushima City, those prefectural governments actually acted very quickly after the disaster. They set up emergency response centers, but those centers were not really able to do very much. They lacked information, they had too few personnel, the resources that they needed, they simply didn't have sufficient resources to respond to the enormous need that was available there. They, in fact, did not have well-established procedures by which they would operate. They called together teams of senior officials. The governors were nominally in charge of those, but they didn't. They hadn't assigned responsibilities. They didn't have decision-making practices in place, so that there was a good deal of confusion at the prefectural level. For the next couple of days, because communications were pretty much cut off, landlines went down, telecommunication systems were down, the cell phone network did not work. There were a handful of satellite phones that were available that allowed at least a little bit of communication. Even aerial surveillance that was undertaken by SDF and other agencies like MLIT was insufficient to really tell what was happening on the ground. And so there was a tremendous information blackout. In the Kante, at the national level, and in ministerial headquarters, there was a similar lack of information and a great deal of confusion about what was going on. The early efforts of the Prime Minister's office to respond were hampered by that lack of information. The disaster was so complex, including, obviously, damage from the earthquake that affected parts of Tokyo, the oil refinery in Chiba, the tsunami damage, particularly in the three prefectures that I earlier mentioned, the tremendous, and then obviously the nuclear accident at the Fukushima Daiichi plant, these demands on the national government were so extreme that it took a long time, a number of days, for them to get organized. Individual ministries did spring into action, dispatch some people, but there were limits to what they could do. First of all, it took days to clear the roads and make it possible to get people there. There were provisions for mutual aid. Eventually, 30,000 firefighters from all over Japan made it to the affected areas. The Self-Defense Force mobilized 50% of its active duty force. By 9 days after the disaster, they had 170,000 soldiers, sailors, and airmen in the field operating. But this was slow to take place, and the degree of coordination among those individual agencies and ministries was quite minimal. So they were acting on their own, and Makante was not able to exercise the kind of coordinating activity that might have made that work better. Only when about almost 9 or 10 days after the disaster was there an effective interministerial committee set up in the Prime Minister's office that on a daily basis met, coordinated, talked about sharing resources, and in general was able to create coordination structures that would mobilize and direct national resources. So in the early going at the local level, there was a combination of response that included local residents who were helping each other, people self-helping, pulling themselves out of the wreckage, some local forces that were able, firefighters or police officers. After a few days, there were units that arrived from SDF and firefighters and national police. But when they were dispatched, whether it was from Tokyo or from the prefectural headquarters, because of the very poor situational awareness, essentially they were given instructions, go to the scene, figure out what needs to be done, and then do it. There was not the kind of information available that would allow for central direction as the structure seemed to dictate. I won't linger very long on the response to the nuclear accident. We've talked about that a lot tonight. Suffice it to say that TEPCO and METI were not able to play a stronger role as might have been desired in responding to the accident. Whatever the cause of the accident, their ability to be effective responders was quite limited. The Prime Minister lost confidence in both TEPCO and METI relatively quickly. But on the other hand, the government was highly dependent, particularly on TEPCO, for information about what was going on, for technical expertise. Prime Minister Khan, as you may recall, made a trip on, I think, the second or third day after the accident to the site of the plant, was widely criticized for diverting attention from the work that needed to be done there to his own visit. But I think in some ways this was understandable because of his sense of responsibility and also the lack of confidence in the information that was coming to him. Eventually, the Prime Minister sidestepped the official decision-making and oversight that was supposed to exist in the Conte for managing the accident response and relied pretty heavily on a small team of political and personal advisors over the initial week or two of the nuclear accident. So a question emerges from this. There is much more detail that we can talk about. I've glided over a number of differences, nuances of the story that might be told. But I think the interesting interesting question to ask about this is this a story that is a deviant case? Is this an example of poor functioning by the Japanese emergency management system and by the government? Or in fact, is this story typical of what happens in very large scale events? We in the United States have faced some of these landscape scale disasters in the last decade. Hurricane Katrina in 2005, the Deepwater Horizon oil tanker and the leak that lasted for several months in the Gulf of Mexico. Other countries, as I mentioned earlier, have experienced those. And so would we place the events here in Japan in a larger category of events, or is there in some sense, are the events here in Japan atypical of what happens elsewhere? I think the answer to that is that in many respects, probably most respects, what happened in Japan, at least at a substantial level of generality, is very similar to what happens in most of these examples, not just in developing countries and in developed countries like Japan or the United States or Europe. First of all, there tend to be unexpected elements of these crises that don't conform to the plans. They're the things that are outside of the planning box, as Scott described it at length in his presentation. And these kinds of occurrences are almost always there. Secondly, these are by no means homogeneous events. Spread out over a large geographic area, one might actually think of them as being a large number of individual disasters that are contiguous, but where there's a huge amount of variation. So we, earlier this week, our team revisited Kesennuma and Rikuzen-Takata in the north of Miyagi and the south of Iwate Prefecture. We had been back there twice before, looking at the progress that has been made in recovery. But the disaster that struck even that relatively small geographic area was highly variable. The experience of Kesennuma was quite different from Rikuzen-Takata, and even in those individual communities, given areas experienced the disaster in very different ways, and people who were at the scene when the disaster occurred, or even people who showed up shortly afterwards, might know what was happening in their spot that they could see, but they wouldn't necessarily have intelligence about what was happening in a broader area. Third, it is almost always the case that communication systems fail totally or are largely disabled. And indeed, we are probably becoming even more vulnerable in our communication systems as we get more dependent on the internet, on social media for communication, on cell phone networks rather than landlines. And while we can compensate for that to some extent with satellite telephones and other kinds of devices, those are never going to be ubiquitous because they're very expensive and very bulky. And the result is that in these kinds of events, communications are likely to shut down almost totally or certainly be disabled to a great degree. Third, there is likely to be a high degree of confusion as a result of all of the things that I've been talking about, and therefore the situational awareness that we would like to have in a big disaster is going to be lacking. Given the highly variable conditions that exist within this large disaster area, the decision making that's required is extremely complex. And almost certainly has to be customized by location. So what makes sense in one place is likely to be suboptimal or even counterproductive if applied in another place. We have to fit the circumstances of a given community or a given area of a community. The response has to fit those circumstances. All of this is greatly complicated in governmental systems like Japan's or the United States or other systems that have independent authorities at different levels of government. These systems are not unified hierarchical command and control systems. They in fact have divided responsibilities by agency, by political jurisdiction, by level of government, and by sector, the public, the for-profit, and the non-profit sectors. So the conditions that I've described First of all, don't go back to, don't conform to the conditions that we might want to make a centralized response structure effective. We don't have robust situational awareness, our communications flows are disrupted. Decision making at the center is going to be highly imperfect because of the lack of knowledge and the confusion and chaos that often prevails in the early days of a disaster. Timely feedback from the field is not likely, and it's not clear, will obviously vary by circumstance, about how responsive the implementers are to what's going on. So these conditions, not just the ones that prevailed here in Japan, but those that prevail in virtually any disaster of the scale of the Great East Japan earthquake, are pretty much a recipe for overloading central authorities, for having breakdowns in the operations of rescue missions, and great difficulty in fitting the response to the wide variation that exists throughout the area that has been affected by one of these disasters. So what are the implications of this? I think there are some very important ones. Being able to effectively respond to a disaster means being able to take effective, adaptive action in extremely high-pressure circumstances and in a way that has complexity that goes beyond the capability of impaired central decision makers to be able to deal with that. Those decision makers are going to lack information, they're going to lack knowledge about the pre-disaster conditions at the local level and certainly the post-disaster conditions, and the sheer volume of decision making and communications that are necessary for guiding operations are going to be great. It may or too great for them to be able to manage. There can be exacerbating circumstances. So in the crisis management headquarters in the Kante, because there was concern that there might be eavesdropping by foreign governments, can't imagine what government might be eavesdropping on the Japanese government. There was shielding that made it difficult for cell phones to operate there, which meant that the very crisis managers had a very limited number of telephone lines and other communications equipment that would get them information of what was happening on the outside. But even if some of those difficulties were not present, the sheer volume of decisions, processing of information, and the enormous complexity of the situation was going to make it extremely difficult for the central government to be able to make decisions. So, of necessity, local responders are going from the district that's affected, and people who are able to make it to the scene, the firefighters, the people from the MLIT, the regional bureau in Tohoku, SDF people who arrive, people who show up in Rikuzen-Takata or Kesennuma or Kamaishi are going to have to work with those local responders and deal with the circumstances that they find and adapt to the conditions that are prevailing there at the scene. And they're going to have to do that without having direction from higher up. Even at the prefectural level, the decision-making situation and the information and communication difficulties overwhelm the ability of prefectural officials to offer that kind of direction. So I would argue, given that I think this is typical of the large-scale disasters that I mentioned, Typhoon Haiyan, the Wenchuan earthquake, the Nepal earthquake, whether you're speaking of a highly developed country or one that is still in stages of development, we don't have a choice about making centralized direction work. The real choice is, can we make a necessarily decentralized response work well, or are we going to have a decentralized response that is deficient and operates poorly and serves the people who need help the most in a very ineffective way? Two questions I think arise from this when we think about framing the issue this way. One of them is, how do we make that decentralized response work well? What are the things that we can do either before the disaster or during the disaster that will make a highly decentralized adaptive response be effective? And the second question is there in fact a role for the Senate? If they can't direct, what is in fact the responsibility and activity that they're going to pursue? So let me suggest that there's an alternative way of thinking about this, that I've, rather than central direction, that will, in fact, I think, shed some light on these questions. And we can think about this alternative paradigm as being decentralized intelligent adaptation. So each of those words, I think, is important. Decentralized, intelligent, and adaptive. And it's based on the idea of self-organizing systems. And I think this holds a lot of promise for if we can build our systems in this way, it holds a lot of promise for making disaster response more effective. So what are the, what another term that's often applied to these self-organizing systems or decentralized, intelligent, adaptive systems is emergence. And the characteristics of emergence are identified here, but let me explain these by just giving a very simple example of it. Because I think it's counterintuitive to think about complex systems self-organizing rather than being organized in a way that requires direction. So think of the flow of traffic in Tokyo. Under ordinary circumstances, or even under extreme circumstances, the drivers of cars are independent agents. They're in charge of their car. They're not getting any detailed instructions from anybody else except maybe some of their passengers about how to drive. Secondly, they have local information. They look out the window of their car, they scan the environment, they see other cars that are nearby. They will have a sense if there's a stalled truck, if there's obstruction, or some other problem that, needs dealing with, but it's localized information that they're in possession of. Decision making in the traffic system is highly decentralized. It is individual drivers size up what they need to do and they take actions that allow them to proceed. However, quite importantly, it is not a chaotic system. It is, under most circumstances, it is not a system that operates with every person for him or herself. It, in fact, is a system that has a set of general rules that organize the way people operate. So we have both formal traffic regulations and informal rules of courtesy that normally prevail. And that allows traffic under most circumstances to flow very effectively to self-organize effective traffic flow with minimal direction, perhaps provided by stop signs, by traffic lights, and a set of rules about how the system ought to operate. So in effect, what is happening is that that traffic management system established centrally, and either by the city government or by the national government, organizes the inputs, the automobiles, the drivers, and the decisions that those drivers are making. And the result of that emerges as the traffic system operates. What are the implications of this? Given the fact that central command is not feasible, we want to create situations in which the people at the scene are able to make those kinds of adaptations that drivers, even confronting congested conditions, are able to make that allow traffic to be to either flow freely or to unsnarl when trouble occurs. And the role, this is not going to be accomplished by central direction, rather it's going to be accomplished by creating conditions under which, mostly in advance of a disaster, that foster the ability to make effective decentralized response. However, this doesn't mean that giving local actors complete free rein, but it does change in substantial ways the roles that central authorities are likely to play. So how, in fact, is this likely to work? It depends, first of all, on building up local capacity. We want our local governments and assisted by prefectural governments to have capacity to respond to the disasters that they're going to experience and be able to respond effectively, taking account of all of the variations in local conditions that exist where they are. So how do we do that? It's partly partly a function of local initiative, and it also should be a result of central stimulation and support from the national government. And it aims at creating local capacity, and we can think of this as either municipal or prefectural, that has several characteristics. One is some agreement about the values that we're trying to achieve. What are our priorities in what are our priorities in disaster response? I do a fair amount of work with senior fire officials, and in firefighting, there are some very clear values that where there's widespread agreement about what those are. The first is to do everything you can to save lives. Secondly, it is to protect property, but not at the expense of saving lives. And finally, one tries to save lives and protect property, but not at the expense of the lives of the responders, the firefighters themselves. And firefighters are very clear about this hierarchy of values, and it shapes the way they make decisions during disasters, even very serious fires. And so we want to get agreement on those basic values in disaster response. Secondly, it means developing competence. And that competence includes codifying local knowledge, understanding the conditions at the local level, having, for example, seismic profiles, understanding the safety of various buildings in the area, understanding the road system so the evacuation systems can be designed in an effective way, etc. It means educating and training not only emergency responders, because they're going to be too few, but making sure that other government officials, NGOs in the area, and ordinary citizens are well educated about disasters. Japan actually does a very good job of educating citizens, particularly in vulnerable areas, about what to do in tsunami conditions, etc. The United States could take some very good lessons from Japan in that regard. Competence comes from exercising. It also comes from the experience of, exercising meaning doing drills that might start with tabletop drills with senior officials gathered around a table working on a scenario, but it also might include doing live action drills for responders or even practice an evacuation for ordinary citizens. Responders are going to learn from experience, and competence also is heavily dependent on the availability of adequate resources to do response. Very importantly, there needs to be an operating framework. And I think in the United States, we've been wrestling with this in many ways for since the early 1970s, when a system called the Incident Command System was developed in California by forest firefighters, and it became a standard template for organizing emergency response so that any responder trained in that system, when they came together to fight a forest fire, would know what their role was, would know how different roles fit together. There would be a decision-making system, and they wouldn't have to invent all of that on an ad hoc basis, take the time to do that. This spread to some other emergency response systems over several decades, and in 2002, the US Congress codified this in our Homeland Security Act and declared that this system would be a national emergency management system that all emergency responders in all states and municipalities would use. It's been a slow process to put that in place. It's been a decade already, and it's still imperfect. Japan has not gone very far in that direction, and therefore it is not clear when firefighters say from one part of Japan come together with firefighters from another part of Japan that they know how to operate in tandem, let alone firefighters operating with SDF people or with MLIT technicians and operators. So that operating framework would create the rules of the road that I talked about in the traffic example. It would create a division of labor so people would know what their roles were. And finally, there ought to be specified coordination methods. Japan has taken some very early steps in that direction. The current government adopted a cabinet resolution that at least in a very general way seemed to point in that direction, although it was vague enough that it wasn't absolutely clear that that was the direction that it was pointing in. And I'm not up to date about what's happened in the last year, whether there really has been any effort to implement that. But it would be a crucial kind of activity, crucial kind of policy for the national government to adopt and then to push out to prefectural and municipal governors. What is the role of the center in all of this? Does the national government have an important part? I think, first of all, it needs to be very active in pushing localities and giving them resources to build their own capacity. They're going to be the first responders, but they need help to get ready for that, especially in the many small towns and cities in Japan that are very vulnerable to major emergencies. In the Tohoku area, we've been in Iwate the past week. We're going with Kyle and his team and Scott next week to Fukushima to visit cities. Many of these cities are quite small, 20, 30,000, perhaps 70,000. They have small numbers of bureaucrats, even much smaller numbers of emergency responders, and they need help in order to build their capacity. Second thing is that, and that capacity is going to be, the national government can do that by setting standards, by providing financial support, by helping with training and exercising, and in some cases providing specialized expertise that is beyond the capacity of individual communities or even prefectural governments. Secondly, is to create the kind of structure that I described, something akin to the incident command system in the United States. Obviously, it would need to have Japanese characteristics, not be the American system imported whole. But the idea of having a system that everybody agrees on that would allow rapid mobilization and organization of responders across across different agencies and jurisdictions. Indeed, the military operates in this fashion. The Self-Defense Force or the American military have standard ways of operating because it's high in a battlefield situation or fighting a natural disaster. Many teams come together that have never worked together before. They might come even from different services, the Marine Service and the land forces. There will be no personal relationships among most of the people present. And if they don't have a system for relating to each other and organizing their work, they will both be ineffective and they will endanger the people who come together. So the military has dealt with this system, that system or an adaptation of it has not been designed for the civilian sector and the SDF, at least as I understand it, and I could be corrected, the SDF has not prepared itself to mesh with civilian forces in the way that was required by the response to the Great East Japan earthquake. The center has a role during disasters as well as before it. I've emphasized the before status, and I think that in certain respects is the most important, building that local capacity so that it's able to spring into action when a big disaster occurs. But during a disaster response, there are a number of things that can be done. One is establishing overall goals and priorities. This central government is going to have the big picture. Someone in an individual town in Miyagi Prefecture is not going to know exactly what's happening alongside it, let alone in other prefectures. They don't know where. They know that they have needs, but they may not be aware that there are other places that have even more needs for resources. So
that establishing overall goals, establishing priorities, disseminating big picture information out to the field is a critical function for the center. It may take a while to acquire that and to process it and understand what's happening, just as we talked about in terms of the nuclear accident. But as that develops, that's an important function. Another critical function is being a supply chain manager. Government is going to need to get the resources, medical supplies, temporary housing, engineering equipment, food, sanitary facilities. All of these local areas are going to be overwhelmed, as was true at 311. Central government can organize itself to be a supply chain manager. Japan has a genius for supply chain management and in many ways invented the idea, certainly the modern efficient way of doing it, and that ought to be applied to disaster response as well as to the commercial and industrial operations of Japan. There's clearly a role for providing expertise and specialized capacity. Even a very large prefecture is not going to have, say, specialized nuclear expertise or access to people from universities or other countries who might be able to supply that expertise. The central government is going to have to do that. We're going to make coordination and priority setting across jurisdictions, monitoring progress and revising objectives. So there are many important tasks for the central government or a prefectural government dealing with its localities, important things for them to do during a disaster. But note that none of that is giving detailed direction for what responders are going to do. And we tend to think of a military model as being central command down through a military hierarchy. And yet, in fact, that's not really the way effective military operations go. What happens is that at higher levels, the objectives and the strategy are set, but then the goal, and so goals are transmitted to people at the scene, and they are then responsible for figuring out how to make those goals operative. What exactly are the tactical and operational decisions that need to be made? And an effective military, in fact, doesn't hoard authority and push it up. It in fact pushes the maximum amount of authority possible out to the periphery where people can understand what the local conditions are along with the objectives so that decision makers who have better information about what's happening in individual places are able to make the right choices. This diagram, which I'm not going to make any effort to explain to you at the moment, but I'll leave it up, basically captures what I've just been describing. Right here is the stuff that happens before the disaster in establishing values, capacity, and operating framework. Here are the things that happen during the disaster. The local level is getting inputs, so the central level is giving to the local level inputs on goals and priorities, the big picture, the supply chain, et cetera. If all of that happens, then we can make decentralized decisions and actions that are likely to be effective. And much of this comes back to the issue that Scott and James talked about, which is trust. If we create capacity in advance, then central authorities are likely to have trust in the capabilities of prefectures and local governments. They're not going to feel that they have to take over because those other entities will fail. Instead, they will be able to play the roles that only they can play, but not try to play the roles that they're not likely to be very effective at. So let me pause here. My colleagues and I will be happy to answer questions. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you. So, questions?
Thank you so much for the interesting observation and
the presentation of the theoretical framework. But I think that your framework is based on the assumption that the central command did not work well. It's a time of 3.11. Let me challenge it. Partially challenge it. It is true that there are many areas, issue areas, in which central command did not work to benefit the affected communities, yes. But there are many other issue areas in which central command did work very well, which benefited the local communities. Let me give some examples. One is the national mobilization of police, people, and firefighters. Of course, there were local units, but thanks to this national network which existed before the disaster, the mobilization went very quick and massively. Second, recovery of school education. This is both national and prefecture government things. Thanks to the it's very special budgetary procedure at the national level. The budget allocation to the affected areas went very well quickly. And secondly, at the prefectural level, there were personnel systems in which, you know, the a kind of exchange, teacher exchange programs there. And this also worked very well to benefit the local communities. Third,
may I interrupt for just 1 second? I think differentiating the things that happened in the heat of the emergency in the first week or two from the things that assisted recovery, like the exchanges of personnel that you're just describing, or the allocation of funds. It's on.
No, it's on.
I think it's worth differentiating the things that happened in the early stages of the response when the emergency was at its heated place, as opposed to the things that were organized in many weeks later or even months later, like the exchange of personnel and the funding for recovery is important. I am not talking about that recovery period, but rather about the heat of the emergency.
Are you saying that the framework is different for immediate post-disaster period and
yes,
1 month later?
Absolutely.
Okay, you are talking about only yes, immediately after.
And I agree. I'm not trying to say that everything failed here in Japan. Far from it. There was heroic action, and there were many effective things that happened. But I would say that some of the things that you're citing, such as the mobilization of police, were equally important. The mobilization of firefighters with the predetermined mutual aid system that existed by the Fire and Disaster Management Agency, and a number of other things worked very well. But I would put those in the category of supply chain management. Police were mobilized, they were sent to the area, but they weren't given explicit instructions about what they were supposed to do. They were told to go and work with the people at the scene and figure out what it is that they needed to do. Because the people in...
But it is natural.
Pardon?
Whoever sent to the disaster area will make their own judgment.
That's right? Exactly what I'm advocating. Precisely what I'm advocating.
Nobody argue about that. Nobody oppose that kind of observation. But anyway, let me give one more example. It's Bank of Japan. Bank of Japan very quickly provided cash to the local banks and ATM machines. It helped the people's life very quickly. Of course, there are areas in which central command did not work. One of the best examples is the delivery of disaster materials. And it is partially because, of course, there was no information about demand at the central level. But it was also partially because of the legal framework in which all relief materials needed to pass through prefectural governments. They could not send directly to the local communities. And this confused the things more. So I'm not saying that you are wrong, but I'm saying that you need to look at many issue areas and to make a balanced estimation, I mean, evaluation. Thank you.
By no means am I saying that everything failed, and I hope that I was making a balanced judgment. I think that the issue that I'm speaking of is that conceiving of a system in which the prime minister and individual ministries in Tokyo command the response and make decisions about how the response should be operated is not something that is going to work. And it doesn't work anymore in China, any differently in China. It doesn't work any differently in the United States. It doesn't work any differently in any country because of the chaos and poor information available, the poor communication, the distance in decision making. That is simply an infeasible way of thinking about it. And what we need to think about, I think, are some of the things that you're citing. Building capacity at the local level ahead of time and providing resources and people, sending them to the scene so there can be effective decentralized response to the very varied conditions that exist in a big disaster area.
And I think perhaps for brevity's sake, there were a couple of slides that we typically present on that were left out tonight, but they actually highlight some of those more effective decentralized response strategies here in Japan after the March 11th events. So one of them would be a number of SDF units moving very quickly on a decentralized basis, as well as the Tohoku Regional Bureau under the leadership of
MLIT.
Of MLIT, being very adaptive and innovative in a lot of its response.
Yeah. I think we could tell a story that would have exactly the same general characteristics about the United States response to both Hurricane Katrina and the Deepwater Horizon oil spill and leak in the Gulf of Mexico. New Orleans flooded and the White House didn't know it for 24 hours. How could that possibly be? But in the midst of a big disaster, there are these kinds of information flows, and the failures of information gathering are going to occur. They happen. Similar stories could be told about China's response to the Wenchuan earthquake in 2008. This is not the characteristic of a given national system. It's a fundamental feature of large-scale disasters and the capabilities of governments that are at some distance from it to be able to direct the response in detail. And I think the Japanese system, although not entirely oriented in this way, still, as a reaction to the Kobe experience, has tried to centralize disaster response and basically put burdens on the Prime Minister and the Cabinet Secretariat and the Cabinet Office and perhaps some of the central ministries that are inappropriate for organizing an effective national response.
Thank you very much for the speech. I thought it was very interesting, in particular because the disaster preparation list you have there rung a bell in my heart, because I'm Swiss, and in Switzerland we have an aversion against top governments. We try to be as local and as direct with the neighborhood as possible. And in this respect, I think if you have disasters of whatever kind, the only responsibility for a big government is that you actually help the local government to be prepared. Like in Switzerland we have, it's watering down now, but in the past every household had to have a certain amount of food, certain amount of water. Of course every man had his own gun and bullets with it at home, and we were ready in 24 hours. So this kind of preparation and self-responsibility by the locals, by the individuals, is maybe the most important thing of all. Here in Japan, culture of course plays into it as well, that you actually have a more reliance on big government, that you believe the big government is helping you. We feel as Swiss extremely patronized when the government is telling us what to do. So in that respect, maybe it's also an interesting counterpoint to actually look at the cultural part of a country and how you want to deal with a disaster. Maybe you have a comment on that as well.
I think certainly it's the case that that national culture makes a big difference in preparedness. And I think that.
And I think that, that's much better. I think that it is a fascinating thing to look at the differences in cultures. I've had the opportunity to do some work, at least in Japan, in China, in Indonesia, in Singapore, the United States, and to some extent in Vietnam. Hiromi and I are about to go to Nepal, which I don't know anything about, but we will, I hope, learn something about that. And certainly these cultural variables are important. But I think what I was arguing tonight, and I think it makes a big difference, obviously Switzerland is a country where, under first of all, that there historically have been isolated communities that had to be self-reliant, much as the frontier in the United States was, where we also have lots of guns. And obviously the mountainous conditions of Switzerland make it hard to get relief to communities if there is a major disaster. And so some of those features are quite important. But I would argue too that there are structural conditions of large-scale disasters that are in fact common from one place to another. And especially in very large countries, the requisites of effective disaster response tend to be very similar. And so in comparing China and the United States and Japan, each large country's substantial populations spread out geographically, economic diversity, residential diversity, economic diversity, those countries, the issues of disaster response are very similar.
When it comes to disaster recovery, I think that there are tremendous differences from one place to another. And I died on it. So notice the dependence on communication system, even under conditions of non-disaster, can be very precarious. So I would say that
disaster response has many, many similarities from one place to another. Thank you for getting me out of danger there. While there are many similarities in disaster response, no matter what the political system, when we're especially for large countries, that when it comes to disaster recovery, it's a very different story. And we have looked at the recovery from the Wenchuan earthquake, where there is a command and control economy and governmental system in China, and they did a phenomenal job of recovering in about a three-year period, although with no discretion left to levy local governments, no respect for local preferences. It was a nationally dominated response. In the United States, and to a lesser degree in Japan, we've allowed localities and prefectures to be somewhat independent or self-reliant. Japan, though, has been far more generous than the United States was in nationally funding the response. So I think that the cultural and governmental differences make a much bigger difference in disaster recovery than they do in the structure of the problems that are faced in response.
I think Arn was getting at this, but I agree the cultural differences are very important to take into consideration. But when we're looking at landscape scale massive disasters, inevitably there's going to be so many system breakdowns that in the United States we often say a locality, neighborhood, community, you're going to be on your own for 72 hours, and then outside help will hopefully come along. And I think that would apply to anywhere around the world that's experiencing an event on a massive scale.
And in illustrating what David just said, we heard when we went to coastal communities that were devastated by tsunami, we heard some stories that because there's a countryside where they are more self-reliant than, for example, compared to Tokyo, like big cities, so they would have at least a week supply of food or, I guess, food. And because these there are communities that are very close to houses that were not affected by tsunami, and these people didn't have electricity. So they just had to offer everything that was left in their fridge because it's gonna go bad anyways. So they were actually having a feast at one point that they were eating better than what they would usually eat because they would go bad. Why don't we just eat it? But if that happened in Tokyo, people are probably not as connected with each other. They're probably not as prepared because we are so reliant on 24-hour communities. But at the same time, if you consider the anti-seismic building codes, those were strictly enforced by the Japanese government, by MLID, I think. Without the government strictly enforcing those and the people following those codes, I think the damage would have been much bigger. No one died from the earthquake itself. It was a big earthquake, but nobody really died except for in Tokyo. But it was a tsunami that they were not well prepared because they were not imagined. They have never imagined that big tsunami.
And I think that's both the example that Hiromi just gave of building standards is both a very positive accomplishment of the Japanese government, especially in the pre-disaster period. And it also is an illustration of one of the things that I was highlighting, which is the setting of standards and the enforcement of those standards, so that there is a set of operating principles that guide all of the decentralized operators. In this case, it would be local governments who are making land use decisions and private developers who are building structures.
A question? One more.
We have one right here, Kyle.
You know that in America, so many people have actually served in the military. And so this is a little bit different. I lived in New York in 1967 when there was a blackout. And so I saw what happened in New York. People took over directing the traffic. Local citizens did this. I believe it happened also in California when there was a big earthquake in some place near San Francisco. But Japanese don't tend to do this kind of thing because they don't take responsibility when there is a disaster. And they don't have training. So if anybody could comment on this, because we are going to have a big disaster in Tokyo. It's coming. And of course, if all of you experts could tell us what we can do in Tokyo, that would be great. I mean, that could be maybe another presentation. But so if you could comment on this, I would be very appreciative. Any of the people here.
Let's use a different mic.
I can't pretend to be an expert on Japan, particularly about the cultural issues that you're speaking of. But I think it would be a mistake to say that there were not enormous acts of initiative taken during the response to the Great East Japan earthquake. In one of the communities that I'm aware of, Rikas and Takata, that I've mentioned and that we visited repeatedly over the last couple of years, there were, I think, 52 volunteer firefighters who took initiative trying to close the tsunami barrier and perished because they were trying to do it right until the end. And I think there were many acts of citizens who responded. I suspect that in a major emergency that created conditions of that sort, that people in Tokyo would respond in a similar way. But I think that you raise a second issue, which is, are people given the training and skills that they need in order to do that kind of work effectively? I think in the United States, we do too little of that, although we're doing more of it than we thought. I've become aware, for example, that here in Japan, there's a lot of emphasis placed on preparing children for tsunamis and teaching them what to do in earthquakes. Something that we don't do at all in the United States, as far as I'm aware. And so I think that there are different emphases in different countries. I will leave it to the sociologists like Kyle, to study some of the specific things that you mentioned, because I don't have any expertise on that at all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Everyone, thanks for your attention and patience. This was a really interesting and, I think, information-dense presentation. I also appreciate the dialogue and your questions. You can look at the web pages of these various people, and you can see links to their stuff on our, or at least information about them on our ICS website. I know that all of us are working on books that will be out next year or two on these issues, and I appreciate you coming out tonight. I want to mention that if you have not dropped your Meishi by, please leave it so that we can include you on our mailing list. We also have a Facebook presence. We are a nonprofit organization, but we incur some expenses, so if you are feeling generous, we have a donation box over there. So thanks for coming out, and see you.